I think I told you in the first lecture itself, an introduction to distillation, that normally reactive distillation is treated as a special case of distillation. Like you have enhanced distillation, in which you have azeotropic distillation, extractive distillation, and then they talk about reactive distillation. But that is not true in a sense, because reactive distillation is not just a distillation technique, or it's not just an enhanced distillation technique, because it is not just a distillation column or a separator, but it is a reactor as well. Okay, so it's not only used for separations, but it is used for reactions as well. And of course, as the name says, it is the combination of reaction and distillation in a single unit. That means in a column, on every stage or a particular zone, the reaction is taking place. Okay, somehow I put a catalyst, or sometimes it is uncatalyzed reaction, that reaction is taking place. In that case, how the things change? Okay, can I have a design methodology for reactive distillation? Okay, let's discuss all these issues, but before that, I thought let's try and understand the commercial applications of reactive distillation. Like so I'm going to take you to a different world now. Okay, not really the separation techniques and vapor liquid equilibrium, but I'm going to talk about different processes, okay, commercially important processes where reactive distillation can be used. Okay, so we're going to talk about chemicals, chemistry, reactions and all that. Okay, so we are adding another dimension to our process, that is reaction. Okay, so a reaction taking place, and reaction can be as complicated as possible. Like, you can have the kinetics, okay, depending on what kind of catalyst you use. Okay, it can be a solid catalyst, it can be a liquid catalyst. Okay, and depending on that, you have complex kinetics, and it will affect your reaction to a great extent, or a distillation to a great extent. It is also called as a multifunctional reactor. Okay, reactive distillation is also called as a multifunctional reactor. That means my purpose is to do reaction. Okay, and then the distillation will help reaction so that some enhanced performance is achieved. Okay, right. So it is not just a distillation column, we can call it as a reactor in which distillation is employed, or it can be a distillation column in which reaction is employed, depending on the application that we are looking at. Okay, so it should be taken, reactive distillation term should be taken in a very broader sense. Okay, as far as its applications are concerned. Okay, this is something that we have seen in the very first lecture. I'll just repeat. Okay, you have simple reaction A plus B giving C plus D. It's a reversible reaction, equilibrium controlled reaction, or rather it is affected or influenced by equilibrium. Okay, so if you do this reaction in a simple reactor, law of mass action says that you get equilibrium conversion, right? So if you do it in a CSTR, okay, how much your residence time you put in, or rather you provide, okay, you are going to get equilibrium conversion. But then if you remove one of the products simultaneously during the course of the reaction, then reaction can be shifted in forward direction, leach catalyst principle, very simple, right? So in this case, what I am doing is C. Okay, C, let's see, is a more volatile or most volatile component in the system. So I do the reaction in boiling condition, so that I have vapor going out and liquid going out. There are two streams coming out of this reactor. Okay, now this will be enriched in C, but along with C you have A, B and D. Okay, and here you have ABD, right? But then this reactor will perform better than normal reactor where you have only one liquid coming out, because you are simultaneously removing C, and because of removal of C, the concentration in C in the reactor will be reduced. And if you look at the law of mass action, okay, this will be reduced. Okay, so that the reaction will shift in forward direction, right? But then you have problems, because you have removing A, B, D along with C, there are losses of these. Can I avoid that? I will put a column, right? I will put a column and selectively remove C, efficiently I will remove C with the reflux and all. And if the system is ideal, now you know, okay, if the system is ideal, I can remove pure C from the top. The system is ideal, okay. If it is azeotrope form, then you have limitations, right? Okay, so you are recycling A, B, D back to the column. And same is true here. If D is the least volatile component, see, I am putting some conditions, okay. If D is the least volatile component, then I have a stripper there and I am selectively or efficiently removing D, okay, through a normal distillation technique. Now you consider the entire assembly, okay, you have reactor followed by two distillation column, okay. Can I just club this reactor along, or rather combine this reactor along with the separation units, and I have a normal reactive distillation column, okay, conventional reactive distillation column, where the red part shows that the reaction is taking place, and you have the blue parts, okay, where there is only distillation taking place. So this column is equivalent to this section of the column, this column is equivalent to the this section of the reactive distillation column, and this part where the reaction is taking place is equivalent to this section of the column, right. So you have, this is called a hybrid reactive distillation column, and if I have AB, that is reactants going in to the column, I have not shown that here, then you have C and D coming out from top and bottom, right. So this is possible, right, this is possible. Of course there are many questions, can I do the reaction as efficiently as what I was doing here, okay, there is stirring here, we do not have stirring, but then of course like the reaction is relatively fast, it depends on the chemistry and the catalyst that we use. You can avoid, or you can get, you can use efficient column internals, can have good column hydrodynamics so that the reaction is not affected by mass transfer limitations and all. But as far as the flow pattern is concerned, it will be a plug flow type behavior compared to what you have here, you have a CSTR there, okay. But in fact sometimes plug flow is better, okay, right. So you have a typical reactive distillation column where the feed is going in A and B and you are getting C and D products out, okay. Now you can imagine, okay, like this is really going to be an achievement if you can do this, because normally a chemical plant would have what? A reactor, you have insufficient conversion, okay, you have unreacted reactants, then you have products, you have to take this stream out, then you have chain of distillation columns, right, and then you have recycles, many things, right. But if you can, I can achieve all this, okay, in a single piece of equipment, then nothing like that. It is a good tool for process integration, right. You are bringing all the components of the process together, you are condensing the entire process in a single piece of equipment, okay. You are bringing cost effectiveness and compactness of the chemical plant, okay. So that is reactive distillation, and it is not just, though I have considered a hypothetical example here, it is not, as I said like in the first lecture itself, it is not just an idea or concept, it is commercially applied, okay. Like for example the reaction of acetic acid with methanol giving methyl acetate and water, okay. So you have both acetic acid and methanol going to the column, from the top you get methyl acetate, from the bottom you get water, okay. I am going to see that, I am going to tell you more details about that reaction later, but then this is practice, okay, this is commercial, okay. The entire plant is condensed in a single unit, okay. So that is the potential of reactive distillation. So it is not just the separator, it is a process, it is a process. So it is combination of reaction and distillation, so it is bringing all the components of the process together. Of course it has its own limitation, it is not that we can apply reactive distillation for all the reactions, okay. Like the major limitation, like while I was explaining this, I was making many assumptions, I was saying that C is most volatile, D is least volatile, so all this may not be true in every case, right. So so those conditions should match. Now there will be certain temperature, okay. At that temperature reaction should take place. Now distillation, okay, distillation, there is a temperature is decided by the boiling point, bubble point, right, and that temperature should be same as the temperature required for the reaction, okay. If that, if these two temperatures do not match, then you have constraints, okay. Of course there are ways to play with pressure, okay, you can play with pressure and increase the temperature or reduce the temperature and get the reaction going, okay, but then you have to work out economics and all, right. So this is an example where I have started with reaction, okay, and I showed how the distillation would help the reaction get going, okay, in forward direction. But there are applications where you are struggling to separate a mixture, okay, like the example that I gave you, A plus B, okay, difficult to separate, means you may have formation of azeotrope, or the mixture or the components are close boiling. Okay. Normally the technique, non-reactive techniques are azeotropic distillation or extractive distillation. You add third component, okay, in extractive it will change your VLE favorably, in azeotropic it will form an azeotrope, heterogeneous azeotrope. You can use reactive distillation also, I will add this C, C will react, okay, right, C will react with either A or B, okay, it will form a product, And this product, okay, it is having, it may be having relative volatility which is higher or lower than the other component, right? And I can separate this product, right? I can separate this product and convert it back later on, or can sell if it has a market, okay? So I can achieve the separation by reactive distillation, okay? That is why it is considered as a special case of distillation, okay? There the purpose is to separate a mixture, okay? But the example that I gave you, here the first objective is to get the reaction going, right? So see the difference, right? So it is quite possible to use reactive distillation for enhancing the reaction performance, and at the same time it is quite possible to use reactive distillation for doing separation for a difficult to separate system where you have formation of azeotrope or close boiling mixture, right? And the applications that we are going to see, they are mixed rather, in sense rather, sometimes we have distillation is helping reaction, sometimes reaction is helping distillation, and so on, right? So it falls in the category of multifunctional reactors, okay? It is a very popular concept these days, okay? Try and combine reaction with something else. Now this something else can be either separation, heat transfer, momentum transfer, and all that. That is why the reactive distillation comes in the category of multifunctional reactors, where I am combining reaction with distillation, okay? See, the purpose is to enhance the performance, okay? See, the reaction is synergetically enhanced by means of integrating with one or more operations. In this case, it is just one operation, right? So I am combining distillation with reaction so as to enhance the overall performance of the process. Now, enhance the performance means what? It can be increase in conversion, it can be increase in selectivity, it can be reduction in energy cost, it can be reduction in capital cost. You can imagine, okay, the entire plant is condensed in one unit, how much saving would be there in your equipment cost, right? Recycle cost, okay. So it is not a new concept, it is not a new concept. Way back in 1869, like Solvay's process, like to produce soda ash, like, so they use this concept doing reaction together with distillation, okay. The ammonia recovery in that particular process is done through reactive stripping, okay. So the concept is not new. Why I have put this slide here is to tell you that even in 1869 it was practiced, but not under the name reactive distillation, okay. The concept is not new, reaction is not new for chemical engineers, distillation is not new for chemical engineers. So combining them is not a problem. So it was practiced, but the analysis, okay, today available is quite exhaustive, and many people are working so as to apply this particular concept effectively and efficiently to many other processes, okay, right? And of course it was applied, but not much analysis was available there, okay? Not much theoretical understanding was available there. Later on, of course, people have started working on it, and nowadays it has become very popular, mainly because now we have the tools like simulation, okay, modeling and everything available. There is so much development in catalysis, so that I can integrate these operations, okay. So most of the times they call reactive distillation as old wine in new bottle, okay. Like the concept is not new, but can be advantageously applied to many important, commercially important systems, okay. And we are going to see some examples, okay. So what are the different motives behind the application of reactive distillation, okay? The first one is to surpass equilibrium conversion. We have seen that the first case, A plus B giving C plus D, the Chatelier's principle. If I remove one of the products simultaneously during the course of the reaction will shift in forward direction. Okay, so I reduce the recycle cost. Okay, the methyl acetate example is the best example for this. Okay, then the second objective, okay, selectivity engineering. What do you mean by that? You have a reaction, say reacting system, A giving B, B giving C. Okay, series reactions. Okay, and I am interested in the intermediate product B, okay, right? So if I can remove this B during the course of the reaction by distillation, I can avoid the side reaction of B going to C. I can suppress this side reaction of B going to C, right? And I can enhance the yield towards the intermediate products. That is selectivity engineering. I am going to give you some examples of this as well. Energy utilization. Now, that is the main thing, no? Distillation needs energy. Okay, distillation needs energy, and this energy is always given in reboiler. I don't know, might have come across some literature where they say that thermodynamic efficiency of distillation is very low because you are giving the heat in the reboiler and not on every stage, right. If you do that, then your efficiency would go up, right. So if you have, so, and of course distillation, the energy cost is tremendous, most of the distillation techniques depending on how much reflux ratio you have, right. But in this case, since the reaction is taking place in distillation column, the reaction is exothermic, okay, whatever heat liberated will be used in distillation then and there, very effective use, okay, right. So I do not need to provide extra heat, okay, in the reboiler, the heat is used on that stage itself, okay. So that is the advantage. Of course, I, if I do reaction separately, then I generate steam and can be used somewhere else, but you will lose some, there will be some efficiency loss there, no, heat utilization. So heat utilization is improved, okay. High purity products, okay, sometimes some impurities are there, very difficult to separate. Now this is a real separation operation, separation in which distillation, reactive distillation useful. I can react that impurity with something else, okay, and that product can be separated, okay. Very dilute solutions, reactive distillation may be useful, okay. Difficult separation, I told you about this, close to close boiling mixtures or azeotropic mixture, I can add third component and it can form azeotrope, and another product, it can react, okay, form that product, that product can be separated and you can achieve separation through reaction. Recovery of chemicals, the dilute solutions like say high boiling components like lactic acid, okay, glycolic acid, all these acids, okay, which are high boiling acids, okay, and if I want to recover them from their dilute solutions, okay, how do I do, can I use distillation? Suppose I have 90% water and 10% acid, okay, I have to remove all 90% water, okay, just to purify it, and water is high latent heat compound, okay, so it is not an economical option, okay. So instead what I can do, I will react that acid, okay, with some alcohol, I will form ester, I will separate ester which is volatile, okay, and that ester can be again hydrolyzed back to acid, okay. So such schemes are possible with the help of reactive distillation. Longer catalyst life and better temperature control, these come together, okay. Now it is a very important advantage of reactive distillation, okay. If you are doing a reaction in distillation column, okay, catalyst is always surrounded by liquid, okay, catalyst is always surrounded by liquid, and suppose the reaction is exothermic, what happens normally in a normal reactor, reaction is exothermic, how much ever effort you put in removing the heat of reaction, a slight increase in temperature, okay, you cannot really operate a reactor under strictly isothermal conditions, okay. So that increase in temperature may create some hot spots for heterogeneous catalyst and catalyst may get deactivated, okay. Whereas if you are doing the reaction in reactive distillation column, okay, these hot spots can be avoided. How? Because temperature rise is not possible, whatever temperature or heat is liberated because of the reaction, right, it will be used in evaporating or other vaporizing the liquid, right. And the vaporization takes place at almost constant temperature, of course it depends on the composition, right, but there would not be drastic rise in temperature or there would not be any hot spots created, okay, if you are doing it in reactive distillation column. So I have uniformity in temperature, no hot spots, and then because of that catalyst life would go up, okay. At the same time there is some deposition of the some unwanted material on the catalyst surface, okay, that also is washed away because catalyst is always surrounded by liquid, okay, it is the surface of the catalyst is kept clean, okay, in reactive distillation compared to gas phase reactions or vapor phase reactions, okay. And this is a growing field, this of course this we did in 2004, last 3-4 years we not updated this. But this is the statistics of papers and patents on reactive distillation, okay, that tells that see the way it is increasing, that tells there is so much research going on, that many patents coming up, okay. Some old examples, now I am going to tell you about different processes in which reactive distillation can be applied, but of course these are some old examples. I started with Solvay process where reactive distillation was used for ammonia recovery. And these are the processes where they did not really say that it is reactive distillation. The term reactive distillation became popular very recently, okay, and there are two very important examples which made this particular process very popular. I will come to that later. Okay, solvay process. Now, esterification, Ockham's work on butyl acetate, okay, 1936-1940. Okay, there they used reactive distillation. Any esterification reaction, reversible, okay, Liljit-Lis principle works well. So, he has reported it long back. Okay, commercial production, of course, started much later. Propylene oxide from propylene through chlorohydrin process. The first ever process, okay, where they, what they do, okay, propylene oxide formation, they do it in reactive distillation column. Is a bubble cap tray column, is a homogeneous reaction takes place on the trays, okay, in the liquid pool on the trays. Cracking of dicyclopentadiene, all these are very old examples, and people were using reactive distillation unknowingly without much of theoretical analysis, but quite effectively. Sodium alkoxide, okay, you have alcohol and sodium hydroxide reaction, okay, and you are removing water of the reaction by toluene, right. Ethylene dichloride, ethylene plus chlorine, okay, there is a boiling reactor, okay, like so you remove heat of reaction there, right. Yeah, so let us come to the first example, which is a very popular example. I like to show this before I talk about reactive distillation, and I have told you many times, methanol plus acetic acid giving methyl acetate and water, okay. And this is a conventional process, this is a conventional process in which you have a reactor and followed by, see how many columns, 5 plus 4, 9 columns, okay. Of course, there are many versions of this process, sometimes people use even 12, 13 columns, right. Why? If you get that residue curve map for the system, see when the reaction takes place, you have a quaternary system. Methanol, because it is a reversible reaction, right, is methanol, methyl acetate, unreacted methanol rather, methyl acetate, water and acetic acid. So, four components. Now, it is a nice problem for conceptual design, okay, four components and many azeotropes form, right, and these azeotropes will make the separation difficult. Many means there are two azeotropes, methanol, methyl acetate and methyl acetate in water, okay. And because of that, separation is very difficult. In fact, acetic acid water separation is also a problem. I told you, it's close boiling mixture. That's why you see many columns here. Azeotropic column, extractive distillation column, then you have washing, you have to recovery of solvent, recycle it back, okay. So many things. So reactor followed by so many columns, you can imagine, okay, it's a big plant, right. And look at this, they have converted the entire plant, or as I said, they condensed the entire plant in a single unit, okay, where you have acetic acid going in at the top of the column, methanol going at a, towards the bottom of the column, because it is volatile, no? It will move upward and acetic acid will go down, right. So, you will have better contact of these two reactants. At the top you get methyl acetate, here you get water, okay. So, they use sulfuric acid homogeneous catalyst, okay. Of course, that acid will also come along with water and that can be recovered later, okay. Right, but otherwise you have just one unit, okay, right. Separation was otherwise difficult. Why, how you can achieve all this here? Because the azeotrope is broken when the reaction takes place, right. Extractive distillation in effect is also achieved here by adding acetic acid in the non-reactive distillation region, okay, rectifying section. And the entire design, all the details are available in literature if you want, if you are really interested in it, okay. But, and this is a commercial process, Eastman's process, it is a commercial process, okay. So, you have reduced the entire plant or you condense the entire plant in single unit, so much reduction in energy, capital cost, right, recycle. Another important example which along with methyl acetate made reactive distillation very popular, okay. Methyl acetate and this MTB process, okay. These two processes, the commercial processes started in 1981-82, okay. From that time onwards, about last 26 years, okay. This particular field has so much research going on, okay. MTB, you know the application of MTB, right. It is used as octane booster in gasoline or petrol rather, okay. And it is made from methanol and isobutene, made from methanol and isobutene. It is again a reversible reaction, right. Catalyst used is cation exchange resin. Typical reaction conditions, about 15 atmosphere pressure, and temperature 60 to 100 because the temperature changes in the column, right. This is a flow sheet, okay, a small flow sheet where you have, you do as much reaction as possible in this reactor, okay, and then you have the equilibrium mixture, okay, that goes to the reactive distillation column. It is not that I am doing the entire reaction in reactive distillation column, right. I am doing reaction in the reactor first and the mixture goes out and acts as a feed to the reactive distillation column. See, the color code I am using, red is reaction, blue is distillation, okay. Now in this case, why will I do the reaction first here? Why can't I do the reaction, entire reaction in distillation column? Any advantage doing that? Why do I, actual commercial process, they do it this way. Okay, this is supposed to be the best option to it, okay, instead of doing the entire reaction in the distillation column. Conditions, they are matching anyway, you know, like since the reaction is taking place here, right. Increase the speed, you can increase here as well, no? In fact, if you remove one of the products, that is what I am doing, so the reaction will go in forward direction. There is a practical advantage in this, okay. Huh? Yeah, if you do the reaction in the column size would go up, okay. And reactive distillation column is, in terms of its fabrication, column internals, it is much more expensive compared to a normal vessel. This is just a vessel or it is a fixed bed reactor probably, okay. Here you use very special packing, which is a catalytic packing and which is quite expensive. So reduce the load on this particular column. So you do as much a reaction as possible here till you go to equilibrium, okay, and remaining conversion or further enhancement is done in reactive distillation column, and that is the technique normally used in many other processes, okay, so that you reduce the burden on reactive distillation column, because this is not only expensive but also difficult to design, right. So something goes wrong here, should not affect the entire performance, already you have got some conversion, okay. So for example, in this case I go from 89-90, which is equilibrium conversion, up to 99%. See, with reactive distillation I get about 99% conversion. Now another important point, see why I am doing this reaction in reactive distillation column, because MTB can be separated from the bottom, okay. So as the reaction takes place, okay, as the reaction takes place, MTB is separated, so it shifts in forward direction, shifts in forward direction. Now this isobutene is not available in pure form. Isobutene comes along with C4 stream, right, C4 stream from refinery, it has N-butane, isobutane, right, so many other components, and along with that you have isobutene, and I just want to use this isobutene for reaction, okay, right. So I am using C4, because otherwise the separation of isobutene from C4 is not so easy, okay. So I am using C4, I am using methanol, I am doing this reaction, isobutene from C4 will react, okay. So in this configuration, I have C4 coming out from the top, volatile, unreacted C4 like N-butane, isobutane, butenes, linear butenes and all, right. And then MTB from the bottom, the conversion is almost 100%, okay. Now look at the boiling points, okay, look at the boiling points. Isobutene is the most volatile, right, MTB is the intermediate boiling and methanol is the least volatile, okay, right. Now the mole ratio that they use in this reaction, slightly excess methanol, okay, 10% excess, 5% excess, okay. Now you have some unreacted methanol should come out, right, from these two streams, okay. Which stream it will come from, either this or this? MTB from the bottom, why? Because this is right, okay. Now again you are going by just boiling points, that is why you gave that reason, okay, or the answer. It is ideal, but it is not ideal, huh? okay, that is what I want to say. It is not ideal. In this case, it is a non-ideal system. So, methanol forms azeotrope with C4, a minimum boiling azeotrope, okay, a minimum boiling azeotrope, and then because of that it comes out from the top, okay. You can plot a residue curve map for this system and you will realize, okay, that there is azeotrope between C4 and methanol, which is a minimum boiling azeotrope, okay. That is why MTB comes out, methanol has a tendency to go up, it becomes volatile, okay. So, if you just go by boiling points, okay, you will see, you will say that, okay, reactive distillation may not be useful here because your product is intermediate boiling, how can I separate, right. But methanol being volatile under those conditions, even if by boiling point is less volatile, because of presence of C4, it is volatile, it has a tendency to go up in the column. I can separate pure MTB from the bottom, okay. That is the logic, and that is how reactive distillation works, okay. It is a very popular process. In fact, this process is responsible for the further research in reactive distillation, boosted reactive distillation, work in reactive distillation rather, okay. Very famous, and most of the commercial plant, about 50% of MTB is produced by reactive distillation technique, okay. Another example, this is something that we worked on, okay. Reversible reaction, methanol plus formaldehyde giving methylal plus water, reversible reaction like esterification, this is acetylization reaction, okay, and this product is highly volatile, okay. So you can do the reaction in reactive distillation column, and these are our research, this is our research work, okay, and you can see the enhancement, okay, if you even if you reduce the methanol to formaldehyde ratio, okay, from 6 to 3.5. You get enhancement in conversion, okay, you can reach close to quantitative conversions, alright. Now there are many other examples, this is again an interesting example on which we are also working, isobutene to diisobutene. Now isobutene is, as I said, it is a, it again goes to formation of or manufacture of MTBE, right. But then of course the people are talking about ban on MTBE, right, because of its solubility in water and all that, right. So there is another alternative to MTBE, that you can dimerize isobutene and form diisobutene, and this diisobutene, if hydrogenated, gets converted to isooctane, and this isooctane can be a fuel additive, okay. So it can be a replacement for MTBE to some extent, of course it cannot match the octane number and other properties of MTBE, but to some extent it can replace MTBE because its octane number is 100, okay, isobutene, sorry, diisobutene or isooctane octane number is 100, right. Now what are we doing here? We are doing dimerization, saturation and dehydrogenation reaction in the reactive distillation column. This is one patent that talks about this, okay. Of course, I do not know whether a commercial process is available or is working on this principle or not, but what I am trying to do is passing C4, okay, it is going up. Now in dehydrogenation section, the isobutane from C4 gets converted to isobutene, right, and when the stream goes up, this isobutene gets converted to diisobutene, right, and this diisobutene being high, less volatile, falls down. This is a section of distillation column, okay, it is a rectifying section of distillation column, diisobutene falls down, and then it can be collected from the bottom of the distillation column, C4 goes up, okay. Now it is a very peculiar system where we are trying to use reactive distillation, okay, to enhance the selectivity, right. How will you increase the selectivity? In a normal reactor, once the dimerization takes place, the dimer has a tendency to react again with isobutene and gives you trimer, then you get tetramer and all that. In normal conventional reactor like CSTR or plug flow reactor, because your product is there in the reactor. Now since you are removing that product, that is your dimer, okay, you are increasing the selectivity, you are suppressing the side reaction. It is possible to do saturation also simultaneously, you can pass hydrogen. And if you have a bifunctional catalyst which catalyzes hydrogenation, then your diisobutene gets hydrogenated to isooctane, which is the desired product. So you can have all the reactions taking place in reactive distillation column. Of course, this is an idea which was patented, okay. I do not know whether it is commercially practiced or not, mostly answer is no, okay. But I am talking about a possibility, okay. You can have not just one reaction taking place in the column, you can have multiple reactions taking place in the column, okay. Very interesting case. So they claim that, okay, there is a less equipment cost, less recycle cost, better selectivity, that is what I told you. The general name for this is reactive debutanizer, okay, where you are removing isobutane and converting it to isobutene. Isobutene is converted to diisobutene. So both isobutane and isobutene are removed from the C4 streams. That is why it is debutanizer, okay, debutanizer. Yeah, this is another example. Nylon 6,6, it is a very famous reaction, right? Adipic acid plus hexamethylene diamine giving polymer, that is the adduct rather, plus water, okay. No one can imagine polymerization being conducted in reactive distillation, okay. Of course, we do not do polymerization in the column because you will have practical problems, okay, the polymers, yeah, choking and all that. Right. That is why it is done in a large hold up vessel, okay. This is your reactor, the red color, this is your reactants are going in and the water is separated, okay, and this water separation is very crucial. And so this is not a new technique, in fact nylon process is very old, okay, and ever since, as far as I know, ever since it is practiced, the water removal is done, okay, like unless you remove water, the polymerization reaction would not get going, okay. And if you want a high molecular weight product or nylon of required quality, nylon 6,6, water removal should be quite efficient, okay. So this again uses reactive distillation principles, right. So improved conversion because of water removal, and selectivity can be improved by efficient removal of water. When I say selectivity in polymerization, I talk about the quality of the polymer in terms of molecular weight, because it is quite possible that if say nylon 6,6, you may have different types of nylon 6,6 forming depending on their molecular weights, okay. But I am interested in a very narrow range of molecular weight, exact what is required. In that case, the water removal is very efficient, should be very efficient. So reactive distillation again. C5 streams, I talked about C4 in refinery, now I am going to talk about C5, okay. The C5 stream normally goes to gasoline, okay, or sometimes they make TAME out of it, that is tertiary amyl methyl ether, which goes to again gasoline, okay. So C5 stream has some dienes, okay. Dienes means two double bonds, and they will really these are very reactive compounds, okay, and they will create problems later on if you do not separate them, okay. So these dienes are hydrogenated, okay, and they will form olefins, right. And olefins also can react with mercaptan. Now mercaptan is also not desired, okay, right. Mercaptan is a compound with sulfur in it, and that is not desired if you are letting this C5 go to gasoline, right. So this is to be removed, okay, and this removal can be effectively done with the help of reactive distillation. So this compound, it is olefin sulfide, which is a high boiling component, okay. Once this is formed in the reactive distillation unit, it can be separated simultaneously because of its low high boiling point, right. So we exploit this reaction and remove olefin sulfide, okay, during the course of the reaction by conducting the reaction in reactive distillation column, okay. So this particular diagram shows how we convert the conventional process, how we can convert a conventional process to a reactive distillation process, and there are multiple reactions taking place here, okay. Again it is a patent, and I do not know whether the commercial process exists or not, but again the idea is to rather show the possibility, okay, of doing several reactions in a distillation column, okay. In the first zone, okay, once the hydrogen is introduced, this is a section of distillation column, once the hydrogen is introduced, okay, you have desulfurization taking place, mercaptan plus olefin giving olefin sulfide. This olefin sulfide falls down, okay, so the reaction shifts in forward direction. Hydrogenation, this particular reaction takes place in this particular section. Then you have isomerization also, you go for required C5s, okay, they are particular C5s that which are important in C5 stream, they react with methanol later to form TAME. Okay. So you can do isomerization of this C5 streams itself. There are many isomers of C5, you get a desired isomer. Okay. So that can be done in the reactive distillation column. Otherwise, if you look at a conventional process, okay, you have caustic addition to remove sulfur, okay, then you have hydrogenation, hydrogen compression. So everything can be all these steps can be combined in the reactive distillation unit, and you can have a reduction in capital cost. Now, in this particular case, you have C5 going in, right? And then after all these reactions, I have required C5 without sulfur here, right? Here, and this required C5 or the desired isomers of C5. Can be made to react with methanol to form TAME. So I can have another section here in the distillation column itself. Okay, so you react that C5 with methanol, which will form TAME. Okay, which can be separated from the bottom of the column. Okay, so you have four reactive zones in a distillation column. Okay, of course it looks quite ambitious, but then it's possible to do it. Okay, theoretically it's possible, and of course the advantage is that they have. Claim are high conversion, low catalyst life, then the reactive function is not confined to pure reactant systems. Okay, you can use even a mixture. Energy utilization. So remember, I am talking about various motives behind the applications of reactive distillation. So far we have seen how reactive distillation can be used to enhance the conversion, it can be used to enhance the selectivity. Now I am going to talk about another example where you have reactive distillation being used for energy utilization, and it is used for increasing the selectivity as well in just one process, and this process is making ethylene glycol from ethylene oxide, EO2EG, right. So this is the process, and by doing this, again see A plus B giving C and C plus A giving D. So it is a series parallel reaction, and if I remove this product simultaneously during the course of the reaction, okay, then I can suppress the side reaction. This is second reaction, is side reaction. Okay. So as and when this ethylene glycol is formed, okay, it has to be removed, and distillation column helps me do that. Okay. Right. I suppress the side reaction. Again, look at the heat of reaction, very high, and I can use this heat in the column itself. Right. So energy utilization. So like this, there are many examples. We can use energy of alkylation. Now this reaction is for cumene production. Cumene, a famous process for phenol manufacture. Okay, which uses benzene plus propylene giving isopropyl benzene, then isopropyl benzene. That is nothing but cumene. Okay, and this cumene then on hydrolysis or other, then cumene is oxidized to cumene hydroperoxide, and this hydroperoxide and hydrolysis gives phenol and acetone, right. So that is the process. Okay. So the first part, that is alkylation part, can be performed, and there are patents, and I think it has been commercialized, can be done in reactive distillation column, and it is again highly exothermic reaction, and you can use the heat of reaction. Okay, to for distillation, right? And here you are increasing the selectivity as well, because you have other products formed. See, benzene plus propylene giving cumene, but at the same time cumene plus propylene can give you diisopropyl benzene, triisopropyl benzene, and so on. So this multi alkylation, okay, can be suppressed. So the again advantage in terms of selectivity improvement. This example, we have done this in our lab as well, acetone giving diacetone alcohol and mesityl oxide. Again, it is A going to B going to C type reaction, you increasing selectivity. These are all commercial examples, okay, commercially important example. Chlorinations for that matter. Okay, if you are doing chlorination of any hydrocarbon, like you have many products formed, like monochlorinated, dichlorinated, trichlorinated. Okay. So again, it is a selectivity issue. Okay, that you, if you remove monochlorinated as and when it forms, I can avoid dichlorinated product, I can avoid trichlorinated product, right. So there are many examples I have given here. Close boiling mixtures, I told you difficult to separate, okay. Cyclohexene, cyclohexane, boiling point difference is just 1.5 degree centigrade, okay. Right, this particular mixture you come across in the process for manufacture of cyclohexanol, okay. So benzene partial hydrogenation to cyclohexene, and you get a cyclohexane as a side product, and the separation is required for cyclohexene to further get converted to cyclohexanol, right. So this separation is otherwise very difficult. So what we do, cyclohexene can be made to react with acetic acid or water, and corresponding product, what is the product? Acetic acid will form cyclohexyl acetate with cyclohexene, or if it is water, it will form cyclohexanol, and both these products are high boiling. So these products being high boiling can be easily separated in reactive distillation column, okay, right. So otherwise the separation was difficult, but since we form cyclohexanol, which is high boiling, the boiling point difference between cyclohexanol and cyclohexane is much higher, okay, right. So separation is possible. Now the question is, what will you do with this cyclohexanol? Cyclohexanol is a market, right, it goes to nylon, caprolactam, okay. So I can use the cyclohexanol, I can sell it as it is. Otherwise, if it is cyclohexyl acetate, it does not have much market. So what will I do? This is a reversible reaction. I will hydrolyze it and convert it back to cyclohexene and acetic acid, and that acetic acid will be recycled back. So it is like azeotropic agent getting recycled back, or extractive distillation where solvent is getting recycled back. Similarly, here your external component will be recycled back, okay. Same is true for orthosilane paraxylene, very famous separation. Of course, this is again not commercially practiced, okay. There is a famous process by UOP, Parex, okay, which is used for separation, but it has been proved that we can do alkylation, and the alkylated product can be separated, and reactive distillation is theoretically possible, okay. Separation, a same example, MTBE, you have C4 and has so many components, I have told you about it, and I am interested in isobutene, I am interested in isobutene, rest are all C4 and there are isomers. Normal distillation won't work, normal distillation doesn't work. Will you go for azeotropic distillation? That also has a problem, because if you use some component which forms azeotrope with isobutene, the same component will form azeotrope with others as well, okay. So this selective azeotrope formation is not possible here. So azeotropic system can, azeotropic distillation also can be used for this. Extractive distillation also not possible. So the best way is to exploit the difference in reactivity. Isobutene has much higher reactivity compared to other components. So what they do, they use C4 and make MTBE out of it. So MTBE, even if you are not interested in making MTBE as such, as a product, okay, this reaction can be used to separate isobutene from C4, and then MTBE can be further cracked or deetherified to isobutene, okay, and you get pure isobutene then, okay. So that is one way of separating isobutene from C4 mixture. The recovery of chemicals, I have given many examples here, lactic acid and ethylene propylene glycol from water, formaldehyde recovery from through acetylization. These are all dilute aqueous solutions, and as I told you before, otherwise the separation is very expensive. You have to remove water, which is a high latent heat component and is highly energy intensive process. But if you use reactive distillation and can you react this component with some alcohol or olefins, okay, in that case you make volatile components, okay, which can be separated very easily, and they can be hydrolyzed back to the original component, right. Acetic acid can be recovered, so much work that we have done here for recovery of acetic acid from dilute aqueous solution through esterification, okay. There are many examples, okay, I have given the references also. Yeah, last example, which is quite interesting, okay, I thought I will include this in my presentation, it is from literature only. This is for making hydrogen, okay. You must have heard about fuel cells, okay. Hydrogen, they run on hydrogen, reaction of hydrogen and oxygen giving water, okay. You have chemical energy converted to electrical energy, very clean way of using energy, right. Now this hydrogen, okay, where will you get it from? Right? You need hydrogen, where will you get it from? Okay. And suppose you want to run a car using fuel cell, right? So you have on board, okay, a fuel cell which will need hydrogen, okay. So will you fill your car with hydrogen? Difficult, right? Not have how much compressed hydrogen you can have, and it's not safe also, right? So the best way is to generate hydrogen on car itself on board, okay. So they're talking about having a reformer. So you feed instead of petrol, you use methanol, and methanol is reformed or converted to hydrogen, okay, and CO2. That hydrogen can be used in fuel cell. That's one way of looking at it. Otherwise, see, the problem is storage of hydrogen. Okay, suppose I have a hydrogen somewhere. I have a hydrogen tank in my chemical plant. Okay, it's coming as a side product. Okay, the question is, how do I use that hydrogen on car, on board rather? Okay, right? Because I can't have, because hydrogen is gas, no, storage. So this is one way of doing it, a very clever way. Decaline. Okay, this is chemical structure, and its unsaturated form is naphthalene. Okay, and this is your hydrogen. If you hydrogenate this naphthalene molecule, the reaction is reversible. Of course, it takes place in the presence of catalyst, platinum and carbon. Okay, if you hydrogenate this compound, you get this compound, and this reaction is reversible. Can I exploit this reversibility now? Instead of filling my car with hydrogen, I will fill my car with decaline, okay, right? And this decaline on board will be dehydrogenated to get naphthalene and hydrogen, okay, right? And that hydrogen will be used in fuel cell. So what did I do? I have used this compound. So its volume is much less compared to hydrogen. So I use this compound, I will fill my car with this and then generate hydrogen on board. Okay, that is the idea. And this is that graph. Okay, in terms of gravimetric content and volumetric content, this particular option, okay, falls somewhere here. That means for the same gravimetric content you have, sorry, for the same volumetric content you have so much gravimetric content. Okay. And this is something recommended by DOE, that is Department of Energy USA, okay, that you should have your compound somewhere here, or your not compound or whatever way of using hydrogen should be somewhere in this region, then only it is going to be economical. So they have shown that if you use this option, okay, use this option, you are somewhere here. So for the low volumetric content, you get very high gravimetric content. Or is the other way around, low gravimetric content you get very high hydrogen, sorry, okay, low. So that's the advantage, okay, of going for this particular scheme. Now where is reactive distillation here? Where is reactive distillation here? This reaction is performed in reactive distillation mode, okay. This is a reversible reaction, right, and this is a small tiny, okay, reactor. A thin film evaporator type reactor they have demonstrated, okay, and simultaneous removal of hydrogen, okay, helps the reaction get going in forward direction, and you can get effective production, or rather the enhanced production of hydrogen on board, right.